Right now, I just returned back driving back to Belgium last night. So, yeah, so far so good, right? So it's been a very extensive, unexpected, very short notice plan where I just jump on the plane Thursday. It was very complicated. And to bring her back out of Odessa, Ukraine. And it was quite of a journey to get there. So I've flown from Washington, D.C. in emergency back to Brussels, rented a car in Brussels after 5,600 kilometers by plane. I decided to drive a car across Belgium, across completely Germany, and across completely Poland. That was a 1,500 kilometer ride over a course of 22 hours straight, nonstop, just get gas. And that was the first part, was to arrive to the northern side checkpoint of the Ukrainian-Polish border. And that was just, it was a mess. Yeah. So even through part of Germany, you could already see some of the extensive of refugees fleeing Ukraine in Germany already as you ride on the highway at this point. My first encounter was I'm stopping for gas, and then there's this girl that's walking on the gas station in front of my car in a bathrobe and a flip-flop. And remember, it's minus 2 degrees Celsius here. And I know that you can take a shower if you need to, but it's kind of weird to see somebody walking across a parking lot when it's minus two in the bathrobe. And I turn right and I see this girl climbing in the backside of a semi truck with a tarp. So I go look at it and I see 30 Ukrainians in the back of a semi. So my heart goes and I talked to them for a few minutes. They didn't have much. So before I left Belgium, I stopped by the store and I packed some serious amount, as much as I could of water, canned food and things like that. I hooked them up with water and things like that. And then I went back on the road, wished them well, continue on toward Poland. And then as soon as we arrived towards the North Gate, that was just mass chaos. In the same time as I was driving after landing in Brussels, we had to pay some bribes in Ukraine to be able to get my mother-in-law outside of the city on a 22-hour ride that she was just able to pack a backpack and to make it to the North Gate, to a city nearby the North Gate. So she rode successfully within 22 hours. They had to stop the train a few times due to shelling and bombings in the nearby train rail. Eventually, they made it to the town of Lviv. And then in Lviv, it was free for all, for everybody. So they all start walking 15 to 20 kilometers from the train station toward the border. And then, there's no kids that should see that. When you see babies on the side of the roads, dead bodies just covered with a blanket, and they cannot bring back people, it's horrible, due to the weather. And then you have to pay a bribe to be able to cross the gate. And if you don't have any access to money, you will wait 2 to 3 days at the gate, and it's minus two and three. Those babies will freeze to death with no food, no nothing. We were lucky they were able to pay a second bribe and get her out within 3 hours while helping some of the people there. It's horrible. I've deployed in countries in the past like Africa and the Middle East, and I've always been shocked to see things like that. But never, never in my life I experienced this level of loss of hope from a country that's 21st century completely fully developed. Yet everything, all humanity has vanished. We have an apartment. We have an apartment of Odessa. We have our belongings there. It's gone. It's all gone. She went to work until Wednesday last week. I said, you got to stop going to work. You got to stop. You work for a fuel company. That's the first thing that's going to get hit by a bomb. Sure enough, they're at the gate this morning. All that is gone. Not when it's a 21st century country. Not like if it's America or Canada being invaded. And, I don't like to say that, but you want to go play war games? Go play war games in the field. Battle within yourself. but don't impact people, don't impact children. There are children being born inside of basement, inside of freezing weather outside, brand newborn babies. Mother, they don't even know what to feed their babies anymore because maybe under the stress, they cannot lactate. I have family member today that are fighting on the front with AK-47. They just give it to them just to save the city of Zaporozhye in the east part. I have my father-in-law, he's a firefighter for the military right now. He's pushing out fires from train being bombed overnight because they're moving refugees through trains. He would not come out either. He will fight for the freedom of his country. The only reason why they not stay there and pick up an AK to go help them, simply because my wife will not allow me to do so. That was my first goal, was to take my mother out and go back in. It's horrible. It's horrible. It's a nonsense, stupid war. And then this stupid war will create so much animosities towards Russian citizen. I have so much friends that are Russian citizen, and it's awful. It's no better for them either. It's not a war that they want. I have so many friends, they will never be able to see their parents anymore. I have some friends of mine that actually send money overseas to help their parents surviving because their pension is like $100 a month. Well, now they can't, so they don't even know what they're going to eat next month either because they cannot export anything back to Russia. 90% of all the troops of the Russian military that we're seeing, it is not a joke. Those people are 18 to 21 years old kids. They have to enlist, and it's mandatory. And you go to training, and then overnight we tell you, you need to go towards Ukraine and start bombing, you know, like schools, bombing hospitals. Do you think those kids, they want to do that? They don't want to do that. But then if they turn around, it's very easy. It's not like the United States where they have court martial. Over there, they have a gun behind their head to say, if you don't do that, you are being executed on the spot. They are moving semi-trucks with cremarium. I never seen anything like it in any of the war I've been in my life. Mobile cremarium to cremate their own soldiers and civilians they have captured and killed. Those are 19-year-old boys. No, those are somebody's son. Well, right now we're doing paperwork for, she was able to bring her cats, thankfully, and her backpack. So we're doing paperwork, so we're expecting and hoping, crossing our finger, we can board Friday and make it back towards the United States. It is never a question. If I would know, I would not. I would have done it in a heartbeat. Nobody would ever leave anybody from your family not being safe. It is not a question. It's you do the right thing. I don't care if I have to be injured or whatever in the meanwhile. As long as I know that my mother-in-law is safe, I will do it in a heartbeat. It's going to be a long, yeah. You know, it's, you know, we have a saying, you know, we always say, you know, in these, the most important is you're alive and you're safe. And this time is the first time in my life I ever understood that that saying is very ironic, because all the people that ever said that in their life never lost everything that they own or worked through their whole life to make. So it's very easy for us to say that until you experience that firsthand. And then you realize that, yes, yeah, sure, you're safe, but you work your entire life for something that is now gone and you have nothing anymore. And that's very depressing. It's very heartbreaking. It's a huge trauma. It's a huge trauma. No, I was very lucky on, you know, we have a business in Chambersburg, and I was able to apply for very quickly done along with Capital One, and I got about 15K on it cash flow to bring back with me. As you gotta remember, countries like that operate all out of cash, right? So that's who you pay people on different, like either the euros, the zloty in Poland, or you can use the hryvnia in Ukraine. So you need cash to pay people and different things. So I dedicated about $9,000 to $10,000 just for the trip itself. And then we dedicated right away another five of my own personal thousand for helping different refugees that we could along the way from here to there and back. So we did that. And then as we continue on, I'm pretty sure that once I'm going to get back stateside, I will try to do my best in trying to operate in, from the distance, and how can I help within the Ukraine through different contact within Ukraine. And I'm really hoping, crossing my fingers, that this nonsense war will be very soon over, because nobody's winning right now. I think people already helped me so much, you know, like, it's all about knowing the truth, honestly. It's about knowing what happened. It's about just treat each other, you know, with love and respect, and don't ever try to make your mind about, you know, Russian peoples are bad because Russia is attacking Ukraine. That is not the case. Don't be, you know, don't be brainwashed that way. Just know that everybody, nobody wants this war besides, you know, I don't know who, top politician maybe, who knows. But most common people, treat them with respect and love, because that's what everybody needs today. And spread the message. That's really all we need. And yeah, you can. And I'm planning to release one last video you know, it really, I think it all started from a video that I made on last week, Thursday, on a platform called TikTok. I don't know if you've seen it or not. They tracked over, you know, 250,000 views within 10 hours. So it went viral across the US. And I did promise, now some of our followers have been following us closely, that I want to make one final video to that cycle, will be the reunion between my wife and her mom.